In 1956, a humble programmer called Edgar Dijkstra was taking a walk through Amsterdam with his fiancée, Maria. Suddenly, he stopped and began drawing and writing on a napkin. His fiancée smiled, thinking he was writing her a love poem. However, after 20 minutes, he looked up and said, "I found it, Maria. Now I can figure out the shortest path from Rotterdam to Groningen," showing her his strange mathematical note. Well, she might not have received a poem, but he gave the world a groundbreaking algorithm. In this video, we will explain this discovery known as Dijkstra's algorithm, which is the most well-known method for finding a shortest path from one point to another. In fact, it's the algorithm used by most of today's navigation system. First, let's point out that in a city, when we choose one path over another, we only make decisions at crossroads. Therefore, a graph theory approach, specifically a network, can naturally model our problem. We denote the set of vertices as the crossroads, with two vertices connected if there is a road between them. Additionally, a weight function can be added to each edge to represent its distance, travel time, or any other metric. The shortest path problem therefore takes as input a directed weighted graph, a source node, and a destination node, and asks to find a path from the source to the destination with the minimum cumulative weight. As you can see here, Dijkstra's algorithm starts with a starting vertex. It scans its neighbors and discovers the shortest path to them, marking this area in blue. Then it extends its frontier by relaxing these edges and adding more vertices to the blue area. This process continues until it reaches the destination or includes the entire graph in the blue area. Once this is done, a shortest path from the starting vertex to each other vertex is found, and in particular the shortest path from the source to the destination node. That's marked out in green right here. Relaxing an edge. So suppose you have two vertices, U and V, with an arc U, V, between them that has a weight of 2. Additionally, suppose each vertex is aware of a path from the source S with costs 5 and 9, respectively, as shown here. Now imagine these two guys having the following conversation.
"Hey, how are you? I'm aware of a path from S with cost 9.
"What? That's too expensive. I know a path with cost only 5. "What? 5? This means that it would cost me 5 plus 2, that's 7 to go through U. Interesting. I'll update my V and cost via variables. From now on, it's via U with a cost of 7. More generally, this conversation can be summarized as follows. If the cost to reach V via U is less than the current cost to reach V, we update the cost via of V and set its via to U.
Now let's see how Dijkstra's algorithm behaves on the following graph. Suppose you want to find the shortest path from S to T. First, the algorithm initializes two variables for each vertex, via and cost via. The via variable represents the vertex just before the current one on the path coming from the source, and cost via is the cost of the path to this vertex. As shown in the example, initially all vertices are initialized with infinity for cost via, indicating that no path is known yet. The exception is the source vertex S, where we know that the distance from S to itself is 0. The algorithm also uses a priority queue, or a heap, shown on the right. Roughly speaking, a priority heap is a data structure that allows elements to be sorted in such a way that you can easily extract the one with the minimum cost. During the initialization step, all vertices are inserted into the heap with their cost via as a cost. Now, the algorithm begins by extracting elements from the heap. In the first iteration, the element with the minimum cost is S. The algorithm processes S and adds it to the blue area, indicating that its distance is now known. Next, the algorithm applies the relax procedure on the edges outgoing from S. For instance, starting with the edge SA, it updates its A's via and cost via values and decreases its costs in the heap to reflect these updated values. After processing SA, it moves to the edge SB and does the same. Once all outgoing edges from S are relaxed, the algorithm extracts the new element from the heap, which is A, and applies the same routine. The algorithm continues this process, extracting the vertex with a minimum cost from the heap, adding it to the blue area, and relaxing its outgoing edges until the heap is empty. By the end of the algorithm, if we trace back each vertex using its via value, we notice that we have formed a tree. This is called a shortest path tree, and it encodes the shortest path from S to each vertex in the graph. In particular, we can trace out the shortest path from S to T here in green, which is S, A, D, B, C, and T.
So here we have the pseudocode of the algorithm, summarizing the initialization routine and the main loop with the relax procedure. Now let's discuss the complexity of the algorithm. First, let Tn, Tdk, and Tdm be the time complexity of insert, decrease key, and delete min operations from the heap, respectively. In the initialization step, we insert every vertex of the graph into the heap. This takes big O of V times Tn time, where V is the number of vertices. Now in the main loop, every vertex is extracted from the heap exactly once, taking big O of V times Tdm time. Also, each edge is relaxed, taking big O of E times Tdk time, where E is the number of edges. So, the overall complexity of the algorithm is big O of V times Tn plus E times Tdk plus V times Tdm. Using a suitable heap like a Fibonacci heap, for instance, we can get the following operation complexities. The insert Tn in big O of 1, decrease key Tdk in a constant time, and the delete min Tdm with big O of log V. So, the total time complexity of Dijkstra's algorithm using this heap would become big O of E plus V log V. Let's prove the correctness of Dijkstra's algorithm. We'll use the following lemma. The prefix of a shortest path is a shortest path too. In other words, if your shortest path to go to school passes through a gas station, it means you took the shortest path to the gas station too. Makes sense, right? Let's prove it formally. Suppose the prefix pref is not a shortest SU path. This means that there is another path, Q, from S to U that's shorter than pref. Consequently, the path P prime, which is the concatenation of Q with a suffix path, is shorter than P, implying P is not a shortest path. This is a contradiction. Hence, pref is a shortest SU path. Now let's prove the correctness of Dijkstra's algorithm by induction on the number of vertices. For the base case, the algorithm works correctly for the initial step as it handles the case of the source node correctly. Now suppose the algorithm works correctly for the first k steps, we will prove it for the k plus 1th step. Let v be the k plus 1th vertex about to be extracted from the heap, and let p be the sv path given by Dijkstra's algorithm. Also let u be the vertex just before v in p. We'll prove this by contradiction. So suppose p is not a shortest sv path. This means that there is a shortest path p prime from s to v that's shorter than p. Well, let's u prime be the vertex just before v in p prime. Using the fact that v is extracted from the heap after u prime, we can prove that u prime must be in the blue area, I mean the visited set. Focusing on the length of p prime, is the length of s u prime plus w of u prime v. By the prefix path optimality that we just proved, the weight of the path from s to u prime is the shortest path distance from s to u prime, which is equal to the cost via of u prime, based on the inductive hypothesis. Thus, cost via of u prime plus w of u prime v is less than the weight of p, is strictly less than the weight of p. However, the algorithm has relaxed the incoming arcs to v and deduced that cost via of u plus w of u v is the smallest one. This leads to a contradiction. Therefore, p, the path given by Dijkstra's algorithm, is a shortest sv path. The algorithm worked correctly for k plus 1, and by induction, for each k from 0 to the number of vertices, the algorithm works correctly. Yuppie. Now that we've proven Dijkstra's algorithm, I have a question for you. What happens if some of the edge weights are negative? Does the algorithm still work or not, and why? Feel free to answer in the comments, and we'll discuss the answer in the next video. I'd like to finish this video with this anecdote in the words of Edgar Dijkstra from his note, The Humble Programmer. It's hard to be a programmer, and it was even hard to get married as a programmer. When I went to marry Maria C. Debet in 1957, I stayed in my profession as a programmer. The authorities didn't accept it since there was no such a profession in the Netherlands at that time. Today, my marriage certificate still shows my profession as theoretical physicist.